All right, so let's get going, and people will pop in as they pop in. My name is Rob Lloyd. I'm the program director for game design and production here at Drexel University, and I am here with Adrian Sandoval, who is representing IGDA Philadelphia. And together, we are very, very proud to present Dan Fornace, Dragon from 2011, and creator of Rivals of Aether. And I'm going to let Adrian introduce himself and introduce IGDA Philly, an incredible international organization, as well as IGDA Philly is a really good local active chapter, especially for our student population from Drexel, UArts, Moore, Camden, Monco, all the different schools in the Philadelphia region. So please check us out. I'll make sure I'll put some links in there once Adrian starts doing his thing. And otherwise, say hi in the chat, and we have a Q&A panel. That's the important thing. My last job is to tell you that along the way, while Dan's presenting, if you've got any questions, just please use on the Zoom toolbar, open up the Q&A panel, and start typing in your questions there. You can upvote and downvote questions, or see if something's already been asked already. Dan might catch them along the way and answer them in line, but he's going to present and then really handle the bulk of the Q&A at the end of his presentation. And with that, I want to pass it over to IGDA Philadelphia and Adrian.
Hey everyone, and real quick, I want to extend a big thanks to Rob and Drexel for allowing Philly IGDA to be a part of this event, and also a big thanks to Dan too for being here this evening. So, as Dan, or excuse me, as Rob mentioned, my name is Adrian. I am the chair of the Philadelphia chapter of the IGDA, which is the International Game Developers Association. We are a global organization who advocate for developers and industry issues and topics that are important to them and their livelihoods, as well as try and connect them with fellow game developers around the world. As for our specific chapter, our primary focus is on our large and vibrant student and indie culture, and we want to connect them with each other, and we also host events with industry professionals and give presentations such as this one, or our regular meetings, which we typically hold on the second Tuesday of every month. If you're interested in learning more about the IGDA as a whole and finding out about the benefits in membership, check out the national website at igda.org. And you can follow us specifically from our chapter page on their website or following us either on our Facebook page or our Twitter so you can learn about the upcoming events as well as some other projects that we're working on. That's really all I have for tonight. So at this point, I'd like to move the virtual spotlight over to our special guest for the evening, Dan Fornace. Take it away, Dan.
All right, yeah, thanks guys. Thanks for the introduction. Yeah, as Rob said, I am a 2011 graduate of Drexel. So back then it was digital media was our major before it kind of split into the multiple majors. So I'll kind of just hop in and go over who I am first, and then basically a story, a history of how I got to what I do for a living. All right, so yeah, I'm 31 years old now. If you do the 2011 math, I think that works out. That's when I was in college. Now I am a game designer slash director is my role, which I believe a lot of people who go into game design kind of hope to do this path. And honestly, it's there's not a ton in the industry. There's way more other positions. So my talk is going to be a bit about how does someone end up in this path of being kind of in charge of, both game design and both also just like overall, the product design and the overseeing kind of development. For those who follow me on Twitter, I have a dog named Sunny who's behind me in this lovely photo. Yeah, that's a big part of what I do now. If you watch, I have videos of trying to teach her tricks and everything. I live right outside Seattle now. I actually moved here in right after college in 2011. So we live outside Seattle, and yeah, and then my final little tidbit about me is I like hockey. I'm a diehard Flyers fan. This is a Flyers shirt that says made in Philadelphia, which I got after I moved because I had needed to let other people know that I was made in Philadelphia. It's very important that they know that. That way, if I'm ever mean to them before I know them, they understand why. It's not, I don't dislike them. I'm just from Philadelphia, so it's not my fault. So yes, I like the Flyers. I watched, I think, all their playoff games this year until they were unfortunately eliminated. And then I also play ice hockey out here in Seattle. I played roller hockey for Drexel in their club team on back when I played, there was like four teams because there was that many kids. I played on B and C, so like the middle two teams. Never made A. They were too good. They were above my skill level. So that's a little bit about me. Like I said, the talk's going to be kind of how I went into the director position. And it's going to be mostly through building games and doing game related stuff, in and outside of school. So to kick it off, here's a lovely picture of me in high school. In high school is when I first started really doing any kind of game development. My very start into it was probably similar to a lot of people, which is just getting into like modding and looking at any game that had kind of any creation tools. So I think the very first thing I did is I had a game called Jazz Jackrabbit 2, which was by Epic Games at the time, like before they became really Epic. And they had like a level editor, so you could make your own levels. And that kind of got me into just messing with games and looking for game tools. I also then got into like RPG Maker, like really early, like 95 and 98. and then eventually 2000 and RPG Maker 2003. So those also got me into like, kind of everything I did early was using other people's assets and like drawing over them. So if you look at the screen, I have a couple examples, like Lord of the Smash was a game that happened because I was obsessed with Lord of the Rings. I was obsessed with Super Smash Brothers. The sprites are drawn over Dragon Ball Z Game Boy game. So like I use the poses and kind of turn them into Lord of the Rings characters. And then the backgrounds, a lot of the backgrounds are actually from Jazz Jackrabbit 2 because I could take, they had like a tile set tool. So like I took backgrounds out of that. So it was like a hodgepodge. Like I didn't really make anything. But I think looking back on it, I have friends who kind of grew up in the game maker scene as well. And like a lot of people get their start this way. And it kind of makes sense as like a game designer to start out doing sprite edits and sprite rips and like just kind of hodgepodging stuff together because like a lot of game development is kind of that you're combining ideas. Even like professional game development is you're kind of combining from different teams things that they, you know, value and consider important and you're trying to make it all work together. So like doing the sprite rip and sprite edit route early is honestly pretty common because especially as, how old are you in high school? In 2002, I was been, what, 13? Yeah, as like a kid, you don't have necessarily all the skills off the bat. So being able to lean on stuff that you like. So that was Lure of the Smash. That one I actually worked on for a really long time. I even started reprogramming it in college, which is another thing you will see is very common when it comes to developing hobby games is being able to hit the restart button. So this game, the first time I programmed it, it was so poorly like organized. It was like a two-player fighting game. And if for those familiar with Game Maker or any object-oriented programming, I had like, I think I had like an object for each character for each player. So there was like player one, Gondor soldier, and then player one, Gandalf. And then, so eventually it was like 12 objects for player one and then 12 for player two. And I would just like copy and paste code between them, because like, I didn't know what I was doing. I was just, I knew how to make a platformer, and then I like went right into a fighting game. So eventually you refine and refine. The engine that was Lord of the Smash eventually does become Rivals. It's all in Game Maker, and it's all throughout, you know, jumping across different Game Maker versions. But yeah, when you start out, you can't assume that you're going to know everything. So a lot of times you just build what you know, and then you might have to restart because now you're way more intelligent and way more organized. So then the other game on the lower left is a game called For the Motherland, which used Advance Wars sprite edits to be the characters. And this game I made at a summer when I was working at a summer camp that was for teaching game design. And like the main development behind it was I would make games that like we would play together at lunch breaks. So this game was kind of like a 2D MOBA before, like around the, I guess before, I don't know, around the time MOBAs were starting to get popular. So like kind of like a same idea thing. And the whole goal was like, there was four bases and you had to get to the end of everyone else's base. And like this kind of helped me kind of get addicted to making multiplayer games, honestly. Just having that kind of lab feel, like the computer lab feel at Drexel was the same feel, where you have people around, you can make changes, they get to play it, you can iterate based on feedback. That's kind of what really pushed me even further towards multiplayer, even though I was making, you know, Lord of the Smash already, which was also multiplayer. And then the final game down there is a game called Frogger Soven. It was like a Frogger clone I made because my cousin is like a wakeboarder. So I like made him a game. And this one was good because it's honestly good to like, I only bring it up as an example, as it's good to make stuff with really small scope when you're early. This one was really basic. But it's, and when you're starting out in development, like you're new to any kind of, you know, game development, it's, I would recommend going for something simple. All right. So then in 2007, I went to Drexel. And then the funny thing for me is when I first enrolled in digital media, I had done a bunch of games as like my hobby stuff in Game Maker, but I didn't want to be a game designer initially. Like when I first got in the program, I was really excited by like modeling and animation. In like 2007, I think it was, like the movie Surf's Up had just come out, and I was like super into that movie, even though it wasn't honestly that good, but I like loved the waves. I was just really into animation and modeling and 3D. So I came into the program expecting like, that's what I'm going to be into. That's what I'm passionate about. And I definitely did enjoy a lot of the classes, and I put as much effort into it as I could. But over time, I just kept gravitating. Like even in my free time in college, I kept doing game stuff. I actually like restarted, like I said, Lord of the Smash, and I was remaking that. So I'll just say like, as a student, my biggest, probably like my biggest strength and was that I was kind of jumped. I wasn't quite sure what I wanted. And I also came into digital media, which was at the time a lot more generalist. And I literally just tried like as hard as I could in every class. So like even the first, well, not like English and stuff, but anything that was in considered digital media, since I entered freshman, like I would just try to like kill all the projects. I was really competitive. Like I'm sure my classmates at the time don't even like remember their projects or care, but I was like, I need to better than this other guy who's always good. So I would be at the computer lab way too much. Like I would like wake, I would basically leave the computer lab like in the morning sometimes and like get breakfast and then like sleep for 2 hours before my first class. So I'll hop in and show a demo reel that I did in 2009, which was during my junior year, I guess. It was at the, this was at the end of 2009. So it'd be during my junior year. And it was mostly projects that I had done kind of like over my sophomore year. So let me show this with some Red Hot Chili Peppers. Smash, let's go. Hobbit combos. This was from Character Animation 2 at the time, or 1. And that was a fighting game that we had tried to do in Unity using the Big Five mascots. So yeah, that's that was like my demo reel at the time. A couple of those are like group projects, and a lot of them were like solo. And a couple, like the big thing for me was that I really liked about digital media is I would basically touch like every part of kind of a project. So like I edited my demo reel. I had like my website where I would put my projects that I was working on as a student at the time. I did, we had like audio classes. So like any kind of sound effects and whatever we would put in. So I think the biggest thing for me is not only was I already kind of being like a generalist, because a lot of the games I was developing in my free time were, I was doing everything except audio. So I was already doing pixel art programming, but I definitely learned a lot of skills around creating games at Drexel. And that was like a big gain, because when I did eventually go indie, a lot of the things I learned around like making a website and basically building around a product, making a website, making a trailer, making everything that matters for kind of building out a full product. I'll put this one on screen for a sec. So this was organic modeling, which was like, the project was to combine two animals. So for those of you who are Rivals fans, you should recognize this panther orca that I made, who I think in the background it says like porca version 1.0 or something. I'm very glad his name in Rivals of Aether is not Porca. But one of the funny things is this class, I think this was the final project, was to combine, you know, kind of two animals as like an organic modeling test. And we also, he looks like a little muscly. That's because we were supposed to like experiment with ZBrush. Like my personal style, I would have had just left him like more like a old school video game, but we had to do some ZBrush, so like that's why he has like muscly arms as a panther. So I did an orca and a panther, and then one of my classmates, Jake Nichols, he had done a lion and a human together. So like the first two Rivals of Aether characters actually come from this class, this organic modeling class. And then the last thing at the bottom is Elementimals, which is kind of the lore basis behind Rivals and behind all the kind of the franchise we're building. like the four elements being the what inspires it and kind of locks it in. And that was done, I forget what you call it. It was like they were thinking of offering a class. So like I signed up to be kind of like an experimental run of it my senior year. So I worked with Jervis at the time to do this. Let me close my Discord since it's pinging us. I have it closed. What? Oh, well, it might just ping us. Yeah, so it was like a test run for what was like an HTML5 and phone gap class at that time in 2011. So it was like the whole game was built in just using HTML5. Like all the game is like divs and JavaScript. And then we used phone gap to like put it, make it into an iOS app. So it was like designed for touchscreens. And that game is still online. If you just search for like elements molds, it should go to like my website and you can play like this old version. And all it was like, I did a clone of Triple Triad and like put more element onto it. Cause that was in Triple Triad a little bit, but not really. And that was a card game from Final Fantasy VIII that I really liked. So like up until this point and still end of my career, if you notice, I just find things that I like and then I pretend like it's mine and then I add to it. So let's see, I think there's a question that's related to Drexel. So before I move on, while I'm still a college student, do you think Drexel prepared you well enough to be a game developer, and what could they have done better, or what did they do well? Yeah, so I think I touched on it a little bit, but the thing I really liked for me was definitely being a generalist and kind of having the skills to, you know, hit a lot of areas. That was definitely beneficial for me. I would say the classes helped me too. I was doing a lot of stuff on my own in terms of pixel art and game development, but I would not have done any 3D or really improved in 3D very quickly if we weren't doing it at Drexel, you know, and had the kind of teachers to lean on as resources. And I really did like a lot of the classes. I think, like I said, my biggest thing was I tried really hard, and it wasn't until like really senior year where there was a couple classes where I'd be like, well, I'm not going to put as much focus because I'd rather focus on, you know, something or with games or animation. But even senior year, I was putting effort in, and I'm glad I did. Like, you know, we had a compositing class, and that stuff ends up being super useful for like when I'm editing videos later for Rivals, just kind of having that skill set. So even now when I don't do stuff, having like the knowledge of the basics of how it works, even though it's very old now on a lot of things, it helps move things forward. All right, and then in college, I was also still making games for fun. I said that I restarted Lord of the Smash. I also did a game jam in, I think it was like 2010 it was like a game maker competition. And I had a buddy, Pete Henry, who is also a 2011 Digum, help me with the trailer because he has an epic voice. So I got him to
In a gaming world,
do this trailer with
me. Ninjas and space marines, comes an unexpected hero. An assassin with skill, speed, grace, and cunning, under a foot tall. In 2010, choose your weasel.
Oh, that's the greatest line in trailer history.
Explore with your weasel.
Yeah, we knew what we were doing. Don't worry about that. If this flew over our heads.
Fight with your weasel.
Those are like actually Pete Henry too, making noises.
Level with your weasel.
Oh yeah, it had like an RPG element to it too.
Thank you. kill with your weasel. Become one of the greatest assassins nature can offer in Blackfoot, the video game. Coming spring 2010.
Oh my gosh, it's so stupid. So that even though I did that for fun at Drexel, it did actually end up coming into play a lot. The music in the game, I had a teacher at the time actually had done our audio teacher had done the songs that are used on the levels, and then the sound effects in the game and in the trailer are Pete Henry making noises. And then the trailer itself, I actually used it for our final at Drexel for the audio class, was to do re-edit a trailer and like redo all the sound effects from scratch. So like the example one that they gave us was like they showed us a Transformers trailer, and then we were supposed to like record maybe like our voice or something and distort it pretty heavily, or like get like drill sounds and like basically refoley it. And like I turned in this, and it actually got like a really bad grade because there's very little like foley work, especially because like I put this Pete's actual sound effects I recorded into the actual game, so like I didn't even have to place those, and then I just recorded it from the footage. And then there was just like a couple logos with like a little sound effect. So it didn't meet like the requirements for the class. So I think I got like a C or a B, but then I also got this sick trailer that I got to put on YouTube. So, you know, it kind of balanced out in the end. But yeah, I mean, at the time I was like given permission. I had talked to the teacher. Like I said, he helped out on doing music for the game and he was helping me. So like I had permission, and it's, if you can and you're doing stuff that makes sense for the class, you can try to combine it in a cool way. So to keep on our trend of epic music, all right, I'm gonna have to shut down Discord. Hold on, guys, give me 1 second. It's running in the background. Okay, it's gone. Beautiful. Max space. So continuing our trend of epic music, I also, my senior year, which is kind of what helped me end up getting a job, was I made a demake version of Super Smash Brothers. So this engine was Lord of the Smash. And then at the time I was really into a game called Tower of Heaven, which was done by another game maker developer that I like kind of knew online, ASCIIsoft. So I had played through that, and it was like a game maker game with a Game Boy aesthetic. And I made like a mock-up of like what, Super Smash Brothers would look like as a Game Boy game. And I thought it was pretty cool. So I was like, what if I had tried to do this and like actually made a game out of it? And I think this was obviously like fan games are a gray area, and you can't like, a lot of fan games do get shut down because you can't like use the rights. But at the same time, for me, it had a couple appealing things. I was making it a lot smaller focused. I was using like a Game Boy aesthetic. The sprites were really small and I was doing the sprites all myself. And I was still in school, so this was my senior year. And it was multiplayer, so I got to like get that feeling back I had in high school when I was making that For the Motherland game. And I got to make stuff, test it with people in the labs, and then make changes. And like, I could be, I had times where two of my friends were playing it on like a, you know, a computer, lab computer, and I'm on my laptop changing stuff. And then I would like save out a build and tell them to try it. I would like buff an attack or nerf something. So on this game, we used a different epic song, and Jake Nichols, who was the person who made the fire lion, or not, it wasn't a fire lion, the human lion. He actually edited this one for me because he was a better editor than me, and I was jealous of him. And this is some blog that we got to promote it at the time. That's the worst link. I drew that link. People raged at me, so I replaced it eventually. Yeah, so for those wondering, that Peaky Geek thing was a blog at the time that was kind of like Kotaku, but like a little bit smaller at the time. And they saw the project early and liked it and wanted to have like the exclusive release to the trailers. And then that actually benefited us because we would just give it to them and they would release it, and then all the other sites would pick it up because they all kind of looked at each other. So this actually like helped us get, or helped me get like some publicity, because fan, like it was a fan game style, and like a couple sites posted about it and Kotaku did. And that really ended up helping because as my senior year was going on, we were doing like our senior project, which was like a Unity game. And there's still videos up on YouTube if you want to check out. It's like me talking to a camera about it. But I was like kind of doing this in my free time. And at the end of the year, Microsoft Studios at the time had like a college hire program, and they'd reached out to Drexel about if there were any candidates. And when I like put in my resume, I like had done some of the stuff I worked on, and I put like Super Smash Land in, and I like put the Kotaku article like just straight up in the resume. I was like, here's a link to it on Kotaku. And then I ended up getting the interview, and I like got flown out to Redmond, Seattle, or like right near Seattle, Redmond, Washington, to talk. And like one of the first guys was asking me, he's like, oh, so yeah, I saw this on the website. Like, walk me through like what this game is. And then he was like, you have like the rights to this, right? And I'm like, nah, man. He's like, yeah, I understand the fed game or whatever. I thought he was like, I thought I was like done. He's like going to grill me for like, he's like buddies with Nintendo or something, but he was just messing with me and being like, no, it's really cool. But I was like, that was the first interview. I was like, well, here we go. Not getting this job. And then I did end up getting the job. I got hired to be a game designer at Microsoft. So I was, kind of entry level. But even to get to this point, so like this is, was obviously like a dream come true for me. Like I didn't ever thought, I think like once I was halfway through Drexel, like, you know, I remember I emailed, I did like so much work for the co-op program. I had, I think I got over 70 gaming studios that I found like their job contact, and I emailed them my resume and my portfolio for any kind of either design, art, any kind of game position I was looking for. So I ended up with like 70 something. I got emails back from four, and they were all no's. Wait. I got emails back from four. Three of them were no. One of them was to send in a application test because they had like a pixel art position possibly. And that was like a studio in Chicago at the time. So then I did the pixel art test, and then they just never responded to me after that. And that took like a week during Drexel courses. So that was a lot of fun. After that, I ended up getting, my co-op was at CHOP doing games for autism research in Flash, which was a great experience for me, but I did not expect, I still didn't know how you even get into the game industry. So then come 2011, when I got the Microsoft offer, it definitely was like a dream come true. And I definitely think having games that were, getting on like something like Kotaku was a huge gain for me to be able to stand out compared to other students, even though it was a fan game. And then because games have this weird like catch-22 where to get hired, you need to have games. And then to make games, a lot of times you need to get hired, like especially because a lot of studios value shipped games. So launching to, an actual platform. Obviously that's gotten easier over time, thanks to like Steam and platforms that are more accessible. You can definitely, ship games to smaller teams now. But yeah, even in college, the biggest thing I can say to kind of get a game designer position is to have, completed games. Because it's one thing to like be able to show design docs or show, you worked on a prototype, but to have a game that, has any kind of press or people can find out about it, or if they know the game before they know you, then it's going to make the interview process a lot easier. So at Microsoft, I did game design consulting, and I worked on the XBLA team. I worked on a bunch of games. When I first got there, it was like Trials Evolution was one of the games that was coming in. And my design consulting was basically shaped around what the project needed. Trials Evolution was almost done, and they were making an amazing game. It's like a Trials, it's like 3D graphics, but like the Trial Bike games that you see, the 2D games from like, you can play online. And all I did for them is I literally would just play their builds and give them back feedback on like the difficulty curve of each level at the time. And they were pretty late. So like they would take my feedback, or they would like reorder the levels and like give it back to me. So I would give them both how long the track took me to beat it, and then what I considered the difficulty 1 out of 10, because they wanted to try to space out their curve. So it felt good. Like they didn't want too many long levels next to each other. They didn't want it to be too many short levels. And like, they also didn't want like too many spikes, but they wanted it to, continuously go up. So like that's basically what I did. And, for other games, I would be in a lot earlier. I would just basically play and write up feedback. Some games were just Google Docs. Well, not Google Docs, since we were at Microsoft. There were Microsoft Word documents of just like anything that I saw, any kind of suggestions. And then others would be more sheets, something similar you would see in like a QA team, but kind of related to design. So like, in Dust, we did something similar to what we did on Trials, where I just played it and I would give feedback on how much gold did I have each time I ran into a shopkeeper, what was I able to buy, what did I buy, what was my level, what was my experience at those points. And then he could kind of use that information to change the cost, change the variables. And then the two biggest games I worked on were Killer Instinct, which was a launch title in 2013, and Ori and the Blind Forest. And both of these being the biggest titles should make sense for people who follow Rivals, because Rivals is a fighting game. I used a lot of what I learned from Killer Instinct on it. I actually have an article on my, I have a Medium. So just search Dan Fornace and Medium if you want to see this article, where it digs into, I learned from working on Killer Instinct, like fighting game design and silhouettes on characters and how they, in, why they are so important to like a fighting game in particular, important to any game design, but particularly a fighting game. So you can read that. It's a good deep dive, I guess, if you're into, if you want to make a fighting game. And then Ori and the Blind Forest. I actually started on that really early, like pretty much right when I started at Microsoft in 2011, I was working on it. And then I left Microsoft in 2014 and the game didn't launch until I think 2015. So like they had a lot of polish and stuff that was all done. I wasn't, you know, at Microsoft working with Moon anymore, but I helped out on like some design stuff. I think like the original like talent tree that they have in there was like a design doc that I turned over to Moon and they took it and made it way cooler. And I just played it a lot and gave a lot of feedback. It was one of my, probably my favorite games to work on. Cause I remember at one point, there was like four of us on XBLA designers and like new games would come in and we'd have to like, you know, who gets assigned to what. And we were playing like all these kinds of games and the quality level was always different. So like anytime there was like a new Ori build, I was like super hyped cause it wasn't like work. It was more like fun to get to play that. And I was also working with a bunch of indie developers at Microsoft. So I befriended a lot of them, but I was also like really jealous of them because I had always wanted to do my own stuff, even like within a couple months of being at Microsoft, I knew it, but I also really liked what I was doing and I was getting good experience. So I kind of set an amount of money that I wanted to save up for myself to be able to like go and try my own game and go indie. So I hit the money that I wanted to save in 2014, in like a little bit after Xbox One launch, it was like March. So then in March, or at the end of March, I told my boss that I wanted to go indie. And I remember before he talked about, because of how often Microsoft was like restructuring and stuff, like he would appreciate it if I gave him like a little bit longer than a 2 week notice if I could, like if I knew I wanted to. So I'd given him like a 6 week notice. We had a couple of games at the time that I was kind of ramping other people up on, other designers. And then Microsoft went through like a big restructuring in April. And they laid like a whole bunch of people in the games division off, like, I don't know, maybe a fifth of the games people at the time, which was massive. And me and a bunch of the designers on XBLA ended up getting laid off at that time. So I had given my boss my notice and his boss already knew, but like no one on our team knew that I was already leaving. So I'm in the meeting and like we all get laid off and everyone's really sad and like I'm sad. I'm like, oh yeah, guys, like this sucks. Like how could they lay off so many, like the big part of the team? And then that was like the morning. And then the people on the team who didn't get laid off come back and my boss like tells everyone that I was already leaving. And then they're like, hey, wait a second, Dan, you're not sad. You are already leaving. And then now I got like severance instead of leaving because there was like a layoff. So I even got more runway to work with for my indie game. So I was like, oh yeah, sorry guys. I was actually leaving. So I am happy, but I'm sad for everyone else. Like I feel camaraderie sadness, but me personally do not feel sadness. I feel great. So that helped a lot because I ended up getting health insurance for 6 months after I stopped and I had, you know, a severance package. So it made my runway better because then I started Rivals of Aether, a little fighting game inspired by Super Smash Brothers. If you've been following the For Fun projects, this makes sense. The element thing also kind of makes sense because it was pooling from Elementimals, The first two characters also make sense. So Orkane and Zetterburn didn't even have any concept art. I just started spreading them. I was like, orca, whale, dog, cat, thing, and lion guy. Let's go. So that was like the beginning development. And let me just hop in. So that was before any concept art. The very first trailer, you can see this buff Orkane. He has muscles again, probably because this is Ryan Seacat, who was also a Drexel 2011 graduate, who did a lot of early Rivals art. And he actually designed Raster, Crag, Forsburn, Maple, Adelis, Absa. Did I say Absa? Yeah, he did all the six base characters, like their initial concept art. And then I did the pixel art for those up until Maple. And then Maple was done by Elian, who now does all our pixel art. But initially, this game was me just doing pixel art with no basis, no background. And I was working with Flashy Goodness, who I met because he did the Tower of Heaven soundtrack, which is the game I said I liked. And then when I was on Super Smash Land, I asked him if I could use one of his songs in it. And he was like, you know what? You can't, but I'll make you a new version. You can use a medley. And I'm like, that's amazing. And then he was like, hey, I saw some of your other stages don't have music. What if I made more songs? And I was like, that would be even better. And then we just kept talking and doing like kind of talking about our projects from then. And then eventually in 2014, I was like, all right, let's make a game together. And that is how this came about. So this is the first trailer from 2014 for Rivals. And this is Ryan Seacat art. This is some dope lore too, written by yours truly. And that all the pixel art is me. So that 2015 kind of worked because that's when we came out on Steam Early Access. So this game started out, like I said, with just me and Flashy Goodness working on it. And then over time, I basically replaced me in almost every regard. I feel like programming is probably the last thing that I replace myself, but even now programming over like this last year or two, I don't do much in Game Maker anymore. It's more making sure our team, we have three programmers, are doing stuff. So the other early Rivals thing I'll do is from that point in 2014, then as we started adding people and the game did well on Steam Early Access. So then we were able to kind of get up to a bigger team. I think probably at the Steam launch, we had like 7 or 8 people working on Rivals. And then we also worked with an animation studio called Studio Yada, and they did some animation for us. So this is from 2017 when we launched on Steam. arcane. Yeah, so that trailer was actually edited by another Drexel digital media graduate, 2011, George Rogers, who is our community manager, and his gaming tag is Edelus. So this guy up here is named after George, and he does pretty much all our community management. He edits the trailers, does our website. So he does a lot of things I was doing early on the Rival. So back here in 2014, I was making the game. I was doing the sprites. I was programming. Then we wanted to reveal it. So I edited the trailer, put together a little website with actually Flashy Goodness did a lot of the website, our composer. But I was definitely doing a lot of hands-on everything. And then over time, we kind of, there's not enough hours in the day, especially as the game was getting bigger. So started replacing. And George is one of the guys who he'd handles a lot more than like a community manager would at, say, like a AAA studio, where you might just be in charge of Discord and doing Twitter. But nah, and when you're a small team, he's in charge of making the trailers. He's in charge of still doing the Discord, the Twitter, anything social. He runs the tournaments. We actually just hired this year someone to work with George on specifically tournaments as our esports manager. And he's from the Rival scene. So he was running a lot of his own events. And now he's working with us officially. And they're doing, but together they do all the online events. So yeah, there's a lot of work that goes in that's not just developing the games. And that's part of what we now do as a team, whereas initially I was doing all of it. But I wouldn't even been able to do all of it or known what to do if I didn't kind of have that generalist education that I got from Drexel. All right, so then late Rivals. This one's fun because if you can tell by the picture, I'm sleeping. This is me sleeping behind the booth at PAX on a Crag plushie that we probably didn't sell. It's actually probably back there. Not that one specifically, but near him, there's still a bag or a box of plushes. And this is a metaphor for now I do even less, but we collectively do more. So like later into Rivals, there is still stuff that I'm definitely doing, and I still have commits in Game Maker because a lot of the features are still stuff that Trevor, our main programmer, blames me for. So sometimes I have to fix it. But a lot of what I do now is kind of directing after this point and overseeing, and just not only kind of picking or kind of fleshing out where the game is going, but also fleshing out the world and making it into a bigger kind of universe. So the first thing I want to show you guys is we did Ori from Ori and the Blind Forest. I worked with Microsoft for that. I had the inside path. I don't know if any indie game our size would, I really doubt any indie game our size would have been able to get Ori as a guest character without me having been at Microsoft, worked on Ori, and I was friends with the Moon Studios developers still. Like, we would still talk, and if we went to an event, we would hang out. So I had the inside track for Ori. And then Shovel Knight, I actually met them at events. If you guys are familiar with indie games, you don't really need an inside track to get Shovel Knight as a guest character, but you do need to be a good enough game, and they thought we were good enough. So I'll show you guys this trailer. And this came out in 2018. Cool. Yeah, so Shovel Knight, the trailer was interesting for us because it was the last character trailer that we did. And everyone knew it was going to be an indie guest, but nobody knew what it was. So we kind of wrote the script around that. It starts off with Rano. For people who like are really into Shovel Knight, they kind of got it as soon as you saw a little bit of the Trapple Pond, like through the portal. But we actually did that kind of visual reference back when we did Ori 2. So what we did is we took like the abyss portal from the Rivals abyss mode. There's like a mode where you fight endless enemies. And one of the things they do is they come out of these abyss portals and then you have to like knock them back into it. So we have like abyss portals that spawn like windows to the other games. So in the Ori trailer, Ori jumps out of one and there's like his stage in the background. And then this one, Rano goes through it into Shovel Knight stage in the game, which is the Trapple Pond. And then Shovel Knight was a lot of fun to work on. We had so many designs for Shovel Knight too. Cause like we couldn't really decide what his like unique thing was going to be. Initially his unique thing was going to be that I wanted to do was, because they were still working on the games. We talked about having a state, like a character select modifier, because we hadn't had that in the game where like you could pick different modes. So like my initial idea was, what if there's a mode where it's regular Shovel Knight, where you pick one where his moveset's a little closer to Plague Knight, and then there's an option where it's a little closer to Specter Knight. So like he would actually change from like using a shovel to using a Specter, or the scythe rather. But so Shovel Knight like only uses his shovel to fight, so like that wasn't gonna work lore wise. And we ended up going with what, in fighting games, there's like a term for it. He's basically like an upgrade character. So he collects like gems and then you use those to buy upgrades during a match, which, is weird and also kind of was hard for us to do in a platform fighter, because there actually is very little time to buy. Even in like the final implementation, it's a little awkward. Like we had to make shortcut keys. So if you're a good Shovel Knight player, you can just do it and quickly hit the shortcut to, if you know your option. We let you do it on when you're respawning, but the problem with that is you actually lose some of your gems when you die. So it's not like a surefire answer. But we think we got it to work, because what we did is we kind of designed his moveset. You don't necessarily need those. They're all just like this benefit that pushes you over the edge. And he was a lot of fun to work on. And at that point, our team, we were probably up to like 12 people working on Rivals. And then also then the year later is when we finally start branching into other stuff. So in April 2019, so we're still doing like DLC characters up to 2018, and we were doing... trying to get a definitive edition done. For those of you who follow us, this September 24th, definitive edition comes out. We had a lot of issues to get to it, but yeah, it's coming out. While we were kind of getting through all our issues, we did waste a lot of time on an April Fool's joke that we revealed. So I'm just gonna play this one.
Have you ever been playing fighting game Rivals of Aether and thought, hey, I love this fighting game, but I also kind of wish it was a
dating simulator?
Well, guess what, dummy? Your dreams are now reality!
All your favorite Rivals of Aether characters, except now they're in high school and look slightly more human. Because this isn't a fighting game, it's a game. Hey, wait a second. I said friendship. It's a friendship game. Don't bleep friendship. That makes me look bad.
This is a wholesome
animal dating simulator.
This is a wholesome
animal dating simulator,
where your primary objective is to talk your crush into going to the homecoming dance,
where there will be unlimited hand-holding and mozzarella sticks.
Hey, don't take my word for it. Just ask my good friend Raster.
Hey, what's up, chicky birds? It's me, Raster. Yeah, this is what I sound like. You gonna meet me by the ding-dong tree tonight? Or am I gonna be playing backseat bingo all by myself? Hey, chicky chicky, chaka, wah wah, yeah, ooh.
I agree. Download Lovers of Aether right now. It's available now.
Yeah, so that's Lovers of Aether, which is a dating sim in the Rivals of Aether universe that it's not canon. It took us like 4 months to develop this, not the entire core team. So like it wasn't any pixel art. So our concept artist who did the concept art after Ryan. So we had another artist do the DLC characters. He actually got started because I wanted him to design a frog character for us. And I reached out to him and he did Rano. And Rano was so sick that I was like, all right, we have like 3 more characters we want to do. And then he did those. And then now he's kind of like the art director for Rivals. He does a lot of like the concept art and just like kind of oversees all of our art. And he's El Rano on Twitter, and Mark Nelson is his name. He did all the art, all the character art for Lovers of Aether. And then we hired another artist to come in and do the background. And we actually outsourced the development of this game to ASCIISoft. Justin, who made Katana Zero and made Tower Heaven a long time ago, he kind of had like an engine for doing a narrative driven game in Game Maker, and he was still refining it. And I was like, hey, can you make me a dating simulator? And he was like, maybe actually. And then even though he was like crazy busy, and Katana Zero was like actually releasing around the time that this was in development, we still made this game and we put it out for free on Steam, and eventually now it's on iOS and Android too for free. I don't really know what it gained, like what we gained from this project, honestly. Like, I think our fans liked it a lot, but our fans already liked Rivals and had it. I don't know how many like new fans it actually brought in, but it was definitely a lot of fun. I think everyone was kind of blown away when we put out the trailer and then we told people to just go to Steam and download it. And then they like downloaded it and it was real. Everyone was kind of like, what the heck? And the game was written by two of Justin's friends. So they had formed a little studio for it, Pizza Freak. And they did all the writing. I basically just reviewed it afterwards. So like all of the characters, the high school versions, are like kind of from like their heads. They took like the little notes we had and ran with it. The one for like Rano, for example, was in his trailer we call him the poisonous pacifist, and then for the rest of the trailer he like beats everybody up. So like his shtick was he talks about being a pacifist and then he fights people. So like all his dialogue is based around him being like a friendly, but then also he just like wants to kick your face off and stuff. So like it was definitely a game for our fans. I hope maybe it got some people into it, but as we're like going into more stuff, turning hopefully Rivals into a franchise, we're definitely going to look for projects that can kind of expand. So people who don't necessarily like, you know, a hardcore fighting game can play something that they like and get to like our characters. Because the lofty goal in Rivals is to eventually, you know, take on Pokemon and take on these other big franchises and compete against them and have games that are good across multiple genres. So in this year, we did a Rivals Direct 2, which was the second time. So we did Rivals Direct 1, which was April Fool's 2018, where we pretended like we were Nintendo and made a bunch of jokes. And then we had a real reveal at the end. Then we did Lovers of Aether the next year. So then the next year, we knew we had to do something even bigger. And we did Rivals Direct 2, which we revealed that we were going to add Tetherball to Rivals of Aether. And then we also revealed Creatures of Aether, a card game. And the joke for Rivals Direct 2 was, it was the same type of humor as Rivals Direct 1, except everything was real. So like each April, we just like increased demand. So like we're getting to the point now where April is our we're like a little studio. I like to think in my head we're kind of like miniature Riot, because we have like our main game, which is Rivals, and they have like League of Legends, and we're starting to branch off into other games using the same world. So this would be like April Fool's is like our BlizzCon basically now, unfortunately. So like this holiday, which I used to love and I used to make jokes on, is now like the most stressful holiday because we had to get a bunch of stuff ready. But in the Rivals Direct this year, one of the things we did is we ended with a kind of like, where are we heading? So people knew like Definitive was in development, and we already announced that it was coming out this summer, which, you know, September 24th is only like 3 days past summer. So I think we pretty much did it. So they already knew that. So like what they didn't know is like, we have already kind of started development or pre-production on other stuff, and we gave people like a tease of that. So this is called the Expanding Aether Montage. And then the other cool thing in this is Flashy Goodness, who did all the Rivals music, actually reached out to like a orchestra to do a version, like a composition of Rivals music. So we have like this epic version of the Rivals song. And that was what closed our direct. And then we had like Adam Carr, who's a YouTuber who got on YouTube making Rivals videos. He's done our last two directs. We love working with him. He basically just asked me like what that was, and I just like leave the room. I don't answer anything. So yeah, a lot of that stuff is like far into the future, still early, but we wanted to tease it off because like we kind of wanted to establish that we're growing, you know, into this brand, and like we have kind of like a path that we're headed, even though it's definitely early to be revealing stuff. We kind of laid out like our 5-year plan in terms of development. And some of them, now that we, April was last year, some of them are already coming true. So maybe we'll be able to hit all our deadlines. Who knows? Because Creatures is coming out on September 28th on iOS and Android. Rivals Definitive is on Switch the 24th, also on Steam. We just did like a workshop build though, and a bunch of the Steam stuff didn't work today. And we have like 7 days. So I'm a little bit nervous about that. But the Switch build does work. So yeah, the 2020 ones from the video are working. 2021 we had highlighted as a comic book set in the Rivals universe. So hope you guys following along, we'll see more of that. And then 2022, 2023 looked like some kind of video game. You'll have to wait to get more information on that. But I will start going through some questions now. All right. Okay, it looks like it automatically does the upvoted ones at the top. All right, will there be a new future for Rivals since the teaser shows a 3D model? So yes, the teaser did show a 3D model, so there will be some kind of new something game, I guess I can say, with Rivals stuff, Rivals 3D models. We're actually working in Unreal for that. So we're skipping right over Unity from Game Maker Studio to Unreal. I personally haven't worked in Unity since 2014. I actually started Rivals in Unity and then realized with 2D sprites, I was still using, realized that I don't know how to use Unity that well. It took me like 2 weeks to like, I was still struggling with just getting the animations to play variable speed the way I wanted it to. And then after 2 weeks, I was like, let me try to set this up in Game Maker and see how long it would take me. And it took me like half a day to get farther. And I was like, I kind of had this vision to make Rivals into something bigger. That's why I wanted to be in Unity, because I wanted to lean on a modern, like an engine that had more tools. But then I was like, you know what, let's just make the game smaller. We'll do like 6 to 8 characters. There'll be no online, and I'll just make it in Game Maker and get it done. And we'll like go from there. And that plan did not work because this is 2020 and it's 6 years later and Rivals Definitive is coming out, and we will be fixing workshop stuff soon for forever after. So yeah, that's why we're in Unreal though. Long story. All right. I used to have access to Game Maker through my school, and due to safety precautions with COVID, I can't participate in the club where I used it. I want to continue building up my profile. Would you recommend I should get Game Maker Studio 2 so I can make better things? That's a great question. So I think I kind of answered it right before. In my story, but I'll address it again. I honestly think there's a lot of value in using an engine or tool that is popular, because there's way more people doing stuff or questions. There's way more resources. There's way more people making assets if you're going to be using, you know, something from the asset store, or for Game Maker's case, it's extensions. So there's way more stuff. But at the same time, honestly, it can be a lot faster to work in what you're comfortable in. I would say the biggest thing is, I always tell any students or anyone young, or even actually any game developer, always scope down, like delete everything you don't need. I will say, if you're gonna do any kind of online multiplayer, to go for Unity. If you're going to do any type of game that feels like it's going to expand into something bigger and it could grow like Rivals could, I would recommend not doing Game Maker, just because there's so many hoops that we had to jump through that no one else was jumping through. So it, like, a lot of times we had to go right to the Game Maker developers to get stuff fixed, because like there's no one else, like we're the only team doing Game Maker Studio Switch multiplayer right now. I mean, not the only, there's probably like 2 other teams in the world doing it. So like the bugs we come across are very specific to us. But if you're doing a single player game and you're doing something that you can, you know, make it really tight and really good, like something like Undertale, where it's like flawlessly polished, but doesn't, you know, it doesn't lean on too many features. It's not online, it's not service-based, it's not, you know, doing multiplayer. So I would recommend going with what you know. Game Maker is definitely really good for that. What would you say to a programmer who wants to get their feet wet with game development? Honestly, the biggest thing I think for getting into game development is to, if you're a programmer, it's like to learn the basic art stuff. Like, I think if you're starting out and you're in a position where your livelihood doesn't depend on what you're making. So like when I was in high school, when I was in college, I was fortunate that like in my free time, I could make games. And I wasn't like working, you know, another job other than in the summers when I was in high school. So if your livelihood is not depending on it, I would say do the other skills, because it's going to make you, one, a lot better in terms of game development. And two, it's going to make you a lot easier to work with, especially on a small team. So like there's guides online for like what they call like programmer art. But like you can basically get started with just, you know, making squares and making circles. And the biggest thing is still making it polished in terms of feedback. So like, even if you have a game with squares and blocks, you can do all kinds of hit effects. You can do visual effects. You can do sound effects. You basically want to do all those things, because implementing that and doing it yourself, you're going to be way easier to work with later. Something like visual effects, for example, if you come up with a good system for doing, say, an explosion with shapes that you've made yourself because you did it with program art, and now you're working with a team of artists a couple years later, the artist might think, okay, I have to animate this like 200 by 200 explosion with this color and these types of objects flying out. A lot of times it's not even worth animating something like that, when you could just, he could just give you a small asset of like pieces, and then you can programmatically explode it. And that's something that you'll have in your toolbox because you did it when you were doing it on your own game. So I would say like learn art, and honestly just try to build something with an art style you can achieve on your own, and make, keep it small. Kind of like the Blackfoot game I did, which was like a game jam game. Keep it small, and then that way it's going to help you a ton when you go and work with smaller teams. Now, if you do want to work in AAA and you do want to work on something bigger where your job is going to be a more laser focused, you can definitely specialize and kind of just focus on programming. The problem is it's almost impossible to get your foot in the door because of that catch 22 I mentioned about game design. So like, unless, you know, your uncle works at Nintendo, without having games, it's going to be really hard. So you do need either smaller student games to even get, you know, the resume or the portfolio. And to work with those small teams, you do need to be a bit, you don't need to be a generalist in terms of, not everyone on the team should be like, I say like a Dan sometimes when we're talking about my team, like a like master of none, but jack of all trades kind of person. You can't have a whole team of that because everyone's just not going to get anything done and just like try to make the game the way they want. But you do want everyone to like have at least a little bit. So like master of one and then jack of, you know, multi areas. So that way they can work together and they can know what each other need. So that's my big advice for starting out, is like, don't just sit around waiting for like another team member to join you or to convince your friend. Let's say you're trying to convince your audio friend or your artist friend to join you and make something. Just go be that person. Know that you're not that good at it, but do the process, get something you can work with, and then you're going to be a lot better on a team. All right, if you don't mind sharing, how much money did you save? All right, I will share. So one, I'm in Seattle, so I was definitely getting overpaid, but I told myself I would save up $100,000 like in my bank account. And it took me 3 years to get to that point, living in an apartment in Seattle and definitely being overpaid for being a game designer. Like when I first got the offer, they told me how much I was going to make. I think it was like $80,000 a year in 2011, which for a game designer is insane, honestly, starting position, college hire. And then right when I got hired, they had just done like I said, Microsoft does restructuring all the time. They just done one and like raised everyone's like the base salary. So I think I started at like $90,000 a year. And then they do performance reviews and you make more money based on what you get, like a 1 to a 5. They like to give you a score and then your salary like actually goes up, which is insane. So like, I remember it was a 1 to a 5 and I was told what they were. Like 1 was good, 5 was bad. Like if you're at the very bottom, like you're looking at maybe getting fired, I think. And if you're at the very top, like you get like a money increase. And I went in for my very first one when I was in like 2012, when I'd only been there a year. And he told me just my number, what it was. And I actually like thought I had like flipped it in my head. So I think I got a 5. I think that was the best, but it was like a 5. So I was like, I was like, oh, I'm just staring at him, thinking about like what I'm going to do when I'm like, what am I going to do in Seattle now that I need a new job? Cause I'm about to get fired. I'm just like staring at him, listening to him as he's still talking, my boss. And then eventually he like stops and he's like, wait, no, like this is the good score. And I'm like, oh, and I'm like, sick. Cool, 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 cool. So yeah, like AAA has like its own kind of systems. And then also if you can get a job in, you know, California or Seattle, the cost of living is a lot higher, but then the pay is generally a lot higher too. Hey, I'm Hunter Wood, the developer of Fallen Angel. I recently got my Switch developer kit. Yo, congrats. That can be a process. And I'm planning to port my game over to Switch in 1 month. I'm also making my game in Game Maker Studio 2. Do you have any advice or experiences? Yeah, so the biggest thing is when it comes to Switch, if there's issues that with the anything you're using in terms of Switch API, the way you resolve that now is you'd use like Game Maker's help ticket, and you hopefully Fritz is the guy who's going to respond to you. So there might be something where you're looking at like, I don't know, leaderboards or any feature that you want to do on Switch. That's like a console specific feature and it doesn't work. Or let's say in the Switch documentation, it tells you you can have like 4 arguments, but in GameMaker it only has 3. Like that's who you're gonna have to hit up, and they might have to give you like a developer build to do that. If your game is pretty light in terms of, you know, Switch integration, then it should be pretty good now. They definitely, the process to getting on Switch isn't too bad. I would just say, make sure you do testing. And then if you have like a release date in mind, you got to get it into Nintendo way earlier than you think. Take it from me. Get in there early. But yeah, good luck on your game. Hit me up on Twitter if I feel like this is familiar sounding, but I don't know if I've checked out your game. But good luck. How do you strike a balance between inspiration and similarity without becoming too derivative? Yeah, we joke about that a lot. So like even in the Rivals Direct, we have a Creatures of Aether trailer and we like say it's derivative that we're making a card game, because like there was a point in time where every kind of franchise was releasing a card game, like Hearthstone and The Witcher card game, which I mean, that was already in The Witcher. And then also, yes, Rivals is based on Smash. Creatures of Aether is inspired by Triple Triad. I think my biggest thing for me personally, like rather than speaking for the whole team, but kind of speaking at it from my mind as a designer, is that is kind of how I design. I take things that I like and I build upon them. And none of my projects am I too interested in taking and replicating something exactly. Even in Rivals, like a lot of the movement and like just the way the game feels is inspired by Smash, but it's also just kind of how, one, some of it's how I thought Smash worked. So like some of our running tech and some of the things players have found are just like bugs that like I thought running worked that way. So now we have something called baby dashing where players can like get a jab that slides because you can dash to neutral in like a single frame. That was just like me programming it. And then other things are just like me building upon it. So like in Rivals, it's really the movesets. I basically early into the game development, I eliminated items because I don't like items. I mean, Rivals is like how I like to play Smash. It's like a competitive Smash. So once I eliminated items, I started to bring the idea of items back and put them into movesets. So like Crag can pull out a rock and the rock can do multiple things, or Ken has his puddle and the puddle can do multiple things. That's kind of how the stage control ideas came about, is like, how can we still make, you know, these like as much intricacies as Smash does with items with just doing it on characters. And then creatures is funny. Like that's probably like, I hope come October, like we get more people in and more people playing, because it really is that idea, like the idea of Rivals, of kind of like adding on top of Smash. This one is like that multiplied, because we took Triple Triad, which is a game from Final Fantasy VIII. You play on like a tic-tac-toe grid. It's like 3x3, and you have numbers on all your cards, and you try to, you know, conquer the board. And then immediately at the beginning, we're like, we're going up to 4x4. So it's like 16 cards on the board instead of 9. And then we already had stuff that I took from Elementimals, which was like, the elements are going to matter. Like, there's these tiles that power you up based on what element you have, which is also part of Rivals. But then now we're just like layering stuff on top of it. We're basically like turning it into Hearthstone, where like, oh, now there's like rival cards where they have like really crazy powers. Like Orkane shoots his numbers across the board, and like Zetterburn burns the board and like changes it. So like, it's going to be familiar to people who know what Triple Triad is. We've had multiple people that as soon as they see it, they're like, oh, Triple Triad. But in terms of how it plays, it's like very different. It's I kind of like to think of it as like Hearthstone Lite, even though like I'm not an adamant Hearthstone player. I play like the Battleground mode in Hearthstone, and then I play like TFT. So like, I'm not a giant card game player, but it's like the same idea in terms of like how they have decks. They have like the hero, we have like a hero card basically. So yeah, that's how I look at it, is how can we take something we like and add to it? I don't really feel like, I think early into development, I always felt like that when people say like, oh, this is just Smash Bros. Like, this is a Smash clone. This is a, this clone. I definitely took it more to heart, but now I don't feel any shame, because I mean, there's only like there's only so much stuff you can do in certain spaces. And two, I like honestly building onto stuff that I know I like already. And that's just kind of how I enjoy working. All right. When not in a global pandemic, what kind of physical space is the Rivals team working into its development, and how often do you pay your team? All right. So yeah, I'll share on this a little bit. Right now, Trevor, George, and I live in Seattle. We would sometimes like work at my house right here before the pandemic. Now we all work from home since March. I haven't like seen their, I haven't seen Trevor's face in a long time, sadly. The team is structured right now. So like everyone is like a contracted employee. So there's like 15 of us now, I think 20, almost 20 people. So the goal is next year, we're actually going to like be restructuring, and hopefully Switch does well and we can like turn it into a real studio with full-time employees that are like part of the studio. Cause right now everyone's contracted. So basically everyone who works on Rivals, with the exception of me, is a freelancer who works contracted hourly on Rivals. And everyone on Rivals is paid hourly, based on how many hours they work. And we have paid from the beginning. So like I said, when I saved up money and then I got that severance on top of it, everyone has always been paid a rate. And then we also will renegotiate rate as like responsibilities and stuff grows. So that's kind of how we're structured. It means like people do have to get their own like health insurance. So like the hourly rate is like higher. Well, not higher, but like it's a high hourly rate to balance out, you know, working freelance. Flashy Goodness and I, when we started it, we had like a rev share on just Rivals, just like that base game, since that was going to be a paid product. So Flashy is the only one who's like not an hourly rate. It's based on how much Rivals makes. He gets paid each month. And then everyone gets paid at the end of the month. Have you considered working with Drexel and taking some co-ops? So yeah, we have considered it. And actually Trevor in 2015 started as an intern. Our biggest problem is like, we're always in the middle of stuff. So it's really hard to like ramp people up. I definitely think a co-op would be a lot easier or more attractive if like we're hiring either like a game maker developer or they were like a Rivals Workshop developer. We hired Geek from the Rivals Workshop community who's been working on Rivals since February now. And he came in because we had like more workshop stuff we wanted to add specific to that community that they were requesting. And he has like the knowledge there. And then also he's a game maker developer, so he's been working on it. So yes, I would be interested, but at the same time, like it's not so much lack of interest, it's just like lack of the organization to do it. Right now, like because of how we're structured, it's basically me as the that all those departments, the hiring, budgeting, HR, everything. So it comes down to if somebody catches me like at a good time, or if hopefully we do finally restructure our company, which the goal is to do that sometime 2021, then we'll have like a real system to be able to look at interns and either temporary or new hires. So yeah, I guess my answer would be hit me up next year and see where we're at. But I'm definitely interested. All right, when designing and developing a character for a fighting game like Rivals, is there a common starting point between building out their moveset, i.e. their best moves that fit their theme the best? Yeah, so Rivals is interesting to develop because we get to, I've always told people like in interviews, it's like gameplay first. So a lot of the characters in Rivals from the beginning have been, we want to fill like a certain niche. Like we want, you know, a heavy character. And like, that's why we came up with Edelus. We wanted like a fast, you know, aggressive character. And that's how we got Maple. And then the other, so like that influenced their major kind of highest level design. And then we started doing the elements to give us inspiration. Like we pooled elements to match. And the elements helped us a lot because it allowed us to come up with new mechanics that are cool, but then we can still shape around the character. So for Edelus, he can use his down special and it hits the ground and it freezes everyone who's standing on ground. We knew we wanted to do like a freeze on an ice character. And we also needed a heavy. So like all of these requirements kind of spiraled into Edelus. And then Edelus, a lot of people hate him. This character up here, a lot of people hate him, but I honestly think he's like one of my favorite designs, like because of those requirements that kind of, pushed it. It's basically the same logic behind doing like the demake of Super Smash Brothers. Like through restrictions, you can kind of increase creativity because you're trying to solve problems in like, you know, you have a small box that you're trying to solve your problems inside instead of a giant box. Because a lot of times, especially in any kind of game design or any design, even product design, it can be so hard to just stare at like a white piece of paper and you don't have anything, you're like, you can do anything. So instead, like on Rivals, like we had this spiraling box that was forming of like the different pieces that we wanted to hit because Edelus was the eighth character. So we knew we wanted a big character. We knew he was water. On water, we didn't have a lot of ideas at that time. We're like, well, we got just regular water. We did fire and we did smoke. What could we do that's not regular water, ice? So like all of those kind of merged, and then we were able to create the character like inside that tiny box. And I think like that's that part, that's kind of how we were able to create like some of the cooler characters, is like having those goals. And then some of the design just comes from like, so like Edelus, like I said, he had multiple things pushing him towards an ice heavy. Claren was literally, I saw the seventh seventh Star Wars in theaters. And I was like, we need a lightsaber character. We don't even have a swordie. We need a lightsaber character. And then that was it. That was like the initial, like, we need this. And then Claren evolved out of plasma, could be a fire element. We want, if we do a swordie, we really like the tipper mechanic from Smash Bros. So how do we like redesign the tipper and stuff like that? So yeah, I think a lot of our characters do, the world or the idea that we wanted influences the character, which influences the world. And then we let it go vice versa too. So sometimes we do gameplay first, sometimes we do world first. And we kind of let them play off each other. How's it developing games without a publisher? Great question, Drew. I talk about it a little bit in my latest Medium post, which I posted yesterday, about why did it take so long for Rivals to get to Switch. I don't know. It's really tough. I feel like games is such a personal development, especially like something like Undertale or something like Rivals when I started it. And it was just me and Flashy for about a year, basically. It's so personal, and like you're reading the feedback and you're like taking everything anyone says, like even bugs are like physically hurting your soul to like get bugs reported. And like any comments, like at that stage of my development career, like I don't think I could have been working with a publisher because like, one, like unless the publisher is like amazing and they care about your game as much as you do, like no one's going to be the champion for your game as much as you are. And two, like you do with most publishers, you sign away either, you know, some of the profit or sometimes even the IP for like a bigger publisher. So like that would have been too hard for me. But on the flip side, all the stuff that a publisher handles is way nice to get taken off your plate. Like all of the console requirements, localization, just like the final kind of quality bar. Some of them will do like testing for you and give you the just send you reports. You don't have to like do your own testing, or it depends on like the deal, obviously. So like there's a lot of stuff that's good for it, but like I think when I had started, like the ownership and just like the connect, like giving away any of the IP would have been like a no-go. So it's definitely possible to do it. It just means you either, you're like on my, on Rivals, it's kind of like me, myself have tried to buckle down and just do that work, even though it takes me forever. Your other option is like hiring people to do that work, which can actually be hard because even though it is like a full-time job, a lot of it isn't done throughout the game process. Like if you take, if your game takes you 3 years, like a lot of the publishing tasks are going to be done over like the last month, let's say 2 months, other than you should be doing marketing throughout. But a lot of publishers don't even handle your marketing. Like that's up to the developer. So like you can't have necessarily a person just sitting around waiting for that. So either it's, you know, a person who has other responsibilities or you outsource it at the end. There are like studios that do like some publishing tasks that are similar that don't take, you know, a publishing cut. You just pay them a flat fee. So that's a long-winded answer to be like, it depends on the game and it depends on where you're at. I think now that I'm getting older, like I definitely see the benefit in having a lot of that stuff offloaded. And I think you'll see as we get more mature, we might start doing publishers for certain regions, just stuff that would be our work normally. So like if we take a game and say like we release some like a mobile version in China or somewhere else that has a lot of requirements that we're not aware of, then we might just let somebody else publish it in that region and, you know, split the revenue or whatever. The economic side of indie development, something to learn on the job or learn in school. That's a great question. So it's really hard to answer it directly. Like I wish it could be taught in school, but there's so much to learn. Like, I kind of do wish I took like a business 101 class at Drexel. So I didn't take any kind of business stuff on the side, or even gotten an MBA would have been really smart for me. I think the thing is though, like a lot of the generic entrepreneur stuff doesn't always apply to games, since we're in a digital market space and like companies can be structured differently. But there is so much to learn. I honestly think one of the biggest things that could benefit schools is like trying to have kids get their feet wet in a lot of that stuff. So like, even if it's simulating the experience, like I tweeted about it. I think what could be cool is like having a class where the whole thing is around like publishing a game. So either you have a game from a different class, or it's something really simple that only takes, you know, a couple weeks. And then the goal is to put it on like iOS, Android, maybe Steam, and have the team just like split up kind of the responsibilities and what is the process of getting on the platform. And even if the game itself isn't going to like sell anything, just the process of like, you know, doing revenue share and the different models for that, and how the team functions. If you could learn that in school, you'll definitely have like a head start on, trying to like make an indie studio right out of college. All right. How do you prevent the game from going in a direction you don't want? I.e. can't be playing can't be is too rewarding, technical characters don't have enough payoff for learning curve, etc. Yeah, so that's definitely a, like thinking about the game in the direction you want, and then also like remembering who you're talking to with the game. So like our big thing is when it comes to campy play, like a lot of our changes, our balance changes are based around like trying to reduce like frustration to play against a certain character, while also trying not to remove too much of the fun of being the character. So like, can't be play falls into that a lot. That's something where you just watch a lot of videos, play it yourself. When it came to like Eliana, I like forced a couple of the people who were like really good at it. I'm like messaging them on Discord. I'm like, play me. And then they like don't do their camping. And I'm like, you have like, just do it. I need to see, like, I need to try to stop it. So like one of our players, Graceful Knight, is just like spamming Steam around the stage, and I'm like Maple, and I like can't do anything about it. So I'm like at first we were reporting the problem, and I was like, I don't know how big a deal it is. And then like a couple days later I play him, and then I'm like going back to Trevor, and I'm like, okay, like what are we gonna do? And that's when we like reduce the amount of steam that gets let off when you like use the attacks. You can't stay in the air as long. So that's one half. And then the other half is like, it's really easy. So like that was a top player I was playing against, and like that was a top player complaint. It's really easy to make a bunch of changes for them and kind of lose sight of the overall feeling of the game. So a lot of our beta testers are pretty much only concerned about, you know, top level play. So me personally am generally the person who advocates for newbies. I think like Raster, I still feel a little bad about Raster. Like, I just don't think he feels that great anymore to play as a newbie. And it's honestly because a lot of the stuff that made him fun at that level was also just busted. His claps were so good. And he also, even like if you couldn't combo, he was just like pretty easy to play. Now I think like he's a bit more niche, like to get results out of him. Like he feels like a little weak unless you're actually really good at comboing. And then there's a lot of people who still believe he's the best character in the game. So like a big thing for me for him is always making sure, if we are kind of peeling power away, how are we making sure the character stays fun at all levels? And just making sure that the game kind of keeps its accessibility. So like, that's the big thing. And then the biggest way, the 100% best answer to that question is just play the game. Like, you got to play it. Like, that's my big fault on Rivals this year, is I haven't been playing as much as I have in the past years, because where I'm just overseeing a lot of stuff, like multiple projects now, and also like working on creatures pretty much every day, doing like stuff design on that. So I'm not playing Rivals as much, but that's the best way to keep the game going the direction you want, is to just be playing it. If it's an online game, be playing against people, because you'll find the frustration points yourself that people are running into when you play. All right, how did you stay in touch with your friends for the future? How do you meet new people? Yeah, so on Rivals, like the guys that, who are from Drexel who work on it, Ryan and George, both of them I kind of just play games with online. George had, me and him played Super Smash Brothers a lot. So like, he's actually like better than me at Rivals, and he has better tournament results than me. He's our community manager. He's just like better at video games too. But he was like the perfect fit because he likes these types of games, and he's also just really knowledgeable. Like, he's played Magic and stuff too. So like, he was the perfect fit to kind of be able to oversee our community and do, and he had done web work at his job before. So he fit in perfectly. For meeting new people, a lot of people I meet that we work with, there's probably the number one biggest place that we've hired people out of is honestly like Twitter. That's how a lot of our artists, that's where I met Mark Nelson, who's our concept artist. Alien is indirectly through Twitter. So I met like Midio on Twitter, who did actually Forsburn's character art. And then at GDC, Midio was there and he was like, oh, by the way, Dan, like, I'm pretty busy. So like, I'm not going to work on Rivals anymore. And I was like, what? Like, he had just started. And I was like, no, dude, like, Forsburn's great. Come on. And he's like, nah, I can't. Like, I can't do it. But here's my friend, Elian. He does really cool pixel art too. You should talk to him. And I talked to Elian. And then Elian has been working on Rivals since the 2015 now. So you really never know, like, how that's going to, stuff's going to work out. So Twitter is the biggest way. Events is the second biggest. That's how I met Trevor. Like I said, kind of how I met Elian, like through another guy. And then the third biggest now is like connections to other team members. So we hired Ian from who works on the Sonic comics. He's our kind of our narrative director for the future stories we're going to be telling in both games and the comics. And then a lot of the people we're looking at for our comic book itself, which is currently looking at 2021, is connections that he has through the industry. So like people that he knows. So yeah, the three biggest would be Twitter, events, and then team members, just knowing people. All right, when you design a fighting game character, this is from Ryan, what are the things you figure out first and what are the things you figure out later? Just a basic progression. Yeah, so first, the biggest thing when I start, because in Rivals, before we did DLC characters, the design process was just like me. I would just do it. And then once I felt good, I would just start. Like, there wasn't anyone to talk to. There wasn't like an approval process. It was just like, I made a design on like a Google Slides, and then I would just be like, this looks cool, let's try it. So I always started with the overall, like, what kind of character is it in terms of like rushdown, floaty, speed, size, that stuff. And then the very second thing I always do, or always did, was specials. What are their four specials? And then how do they interact with the rest of the moveset? So like on Zetterburn, for example, like his specials are all fire. They all light you on fire. His strong attacks send you farther when they're on fire. That's how I like started it. And then from that, I'm able to kind of go move on to normals that kind of can complement or like that kind, like the specials and what I'm designing. So like, for example, Zetterburn's strong attacks are all like grabs, and the idea we had, it didn't really ever play out as much as I wanted it to, but he's like grabbing the fire out of you and there's like this consume effect. So like all the strong attacks were basically meant to be moves that looked like they could grab. Or we do the opposite where it's like, this character is really going to be really good at this. Let's design some normals that like can kind of counter that. So if the character has like a lot of range options, for example, like Eliana, then maybe some of the normals are like her down air or her forward tilt, which are like these multi-hit moves that just like put out a hitbox that lasts long on top of you. And then that gives her like a synergy where she can flip from comboing to zoning when she gets like opportunities, basically. And then a lot, depending on the character, some characters, like I design their specials and like just went into normals and then we just like, we did it and that was the character, and it's had very little changes since then. I would say, I mean, Claren's had nerfs, but probably like Claren, maybe Raster or Kane. There's a couple of characters who like have had just minuscule, you know, changes. And then there's other characters like Sylvanos, and Absa, some of the other zoning characters who've had like pretty big changes after they first were put in, and that's just through iteration and playing. And the design needs to reflect like how the character plays, basically. All right, regarding scope, as a fresh game developer with a passion project whose scope seems to be evolving over time, how did you keep Rivals from busting your mental, physical capacity and Wallace limits? Also a very good question. I honestly think we did a very poor job with Rivals keeping its scope down. It ballooned out of control. We also like made the mistake of like, we were a paid purchase indie game that kind of evolved into a semi-service game. Like we were releasing skins for tournaments and we were selling those skins, and the money from those skins was funding pop bonuses for those tournaments. And like at the same time we were like making balance changes, and then at the same time we were like trying to work on new characters, at least a couple years ago, trying to add more online stuff, all this while like we're still getting bugs and like the game is still running. So like we definitely could have, I probably could have like scoped down earlier and like pole vaulted to a new project faster. But at the same time we had a big like fan base, and we wanted to like make the game as best as we could. So I honestly think like a big part of it is not trying to do too much in terms of like the core features. Like I mentioned it earlier, even something like multiplayer, like if that's not the most important part of your game, like you're not a 1v1 fighting game, for example, then like maybe think about not doing multiplayer if you know that's not the main experience you want to share. Because then that's going to change, you know, your scope. The other thing is like, I know a lot of times in the past, like episodic content was kind of like a big way to downscope. But I think that can kind of be a flaw if you're relying, like if the game's relying on multiple episodes, and like you basically dig yourself in a hole that even if the first one is good, then you might feel like there has to be more done. So I honestly think just like scoping down, kind of treat your first, I don't know, even five games, like all your early releases, like they're a pilot for a TV show. And you're just trying to like give the player the coolest, most important, like the thing that would get this show picked up on ABC. And like a pilot's only one episode, right? Like that's how you should view it. Like this is only one episode. how do you get picked up by your players? And just cut it. Yeah. You cut everything that isn't that coolest thing. All right. Can you explain this from Ryan? Also, can you explain your platform fighter designing philosophy differs from Nintendo? The things that make Rivals characters more built around a central gimmick and the reasons you chose not those shields. Yeah. So the big thing about the central gimmick and like the stage control I mentioned a little bit is early on we decided we weren't going to have items. So we kind of tried to replace items in a sense by designing the movesets to be more intricate and having these different stage control that you can interact with. So that's definitely like a part to it. And then I think a lot of the stuff early into Rivals is like, because we were making the scope smaller, I've mentioned it before, the grabs and shield is because I didn't want to animate throwing animations in 2D pixel art for every character. Because each character that gets added, if you actually have the throws like respond like they would in Smash, which they're sick, but it means every character has like a reaction to certain grabs. Like for example, Charizard grabs you, he holds you into the ground and he does flamethrower, hits you a bunch and then you get launched. Every character kind of has like a short custom animation of them in that grab. And then Smash is a 3D game. So if they have rigs that are, you know, similar amounts of bones, you can kind of have some categories like, you know, a humanoid character does generally this, and then you can tweak it a little bit. So it still takes forever to do custom reactions to certain attacks, but it's exponential in terms of the characters you add. Like you add a new character, now you have to do the grab and throw animations for each attack. So right away, instead of going that route, I eliminated grabs and I was like, we're just not going to do them. And then that influenced a lot of the design. So the whole defense mechanic is parrying. That came about because I didn't have grabs, but I had a spot dodge and it was just like a normal Smash Bros. Spot dodge at first. And then I was like, hey, what if, since we don't have grabs, I made like a power shield version of the spot dodge where you could like stun people when they hit you. And that was only like one frame at the beginning of spot dodge. And it was impossible to do because it's impossible to like time a frame. So eventually that got stretched out over to the whole thing. And then eventually that became like the parry. So a lot of the early engine stuff is around putting either restrictions or, you know, having basically restrictions fueling creativity, like I discussed earlier with the box. And then some of the other differences are, the biggest thing in Rivals is I just pick the stuff that I like about Smash Bros. And remove stuff I don't like. So I don't like mashing out of stuff. I don't like that the optimal way you do it with a controller. Like, have you ever seen some pros, like, especially to get out of stuff on like the right stick, they'll literally like take their hand and they'll do like something like this, like you'll see in Mario Party, or they'll like be clawing it and hitting a whole bunch of buttons at once. That's never felt good to me, to have to like change your control for something. So instead of mashing, everything that's like would have been a mash, like a stun or whatever, has like a different mechanic. So like Edelus has like the ice you roll out of, and Maple, you can't even do anything. You just sit and watch it for a period of time. But yeah, they all, that's kind of how I differentiate. It's basically how I want Smash Brothers to play. All right, from Daniel. Sorry for the long story. I'm trying to get myself out there in the game dev world. After graduating, I worked on a personal project that's years in the making and barely halfway done without a team. I work full-time in retail and barely have time to dedicate to my project. Should I start from scratch and work on smaller projects? And what should I do to prepare myself to get my foot in the door for an actual company? All right, yeah, so this is a good question. Yeah, especially with like working, like I said, it's a lot harder when you have a full-time job and you have a lot of other responsibilities to kind of do the hobby game stuff. I would probably recommend you do what I did like on Lord of the Smash, which that was like my big game. If it's like you get to this point where you plateau on development and like you either don't even want to open it, or you open it and you get very little done, or you open it and you just redo something that you've already redone like three times and is honestly not that important. Everyone kind of hits those plateaus. If you've been stuck on that kind of style, like that working, like no work, worked like busy but not productive cycle, my biggest thing is like pause the game, honestly. Just pause it. Like don't say like you're deleting it and starting over. Pause the game and go do smaller stuff. Go make smaller projects, because that's going to help you come back to this game. So like that's one of the reasons I like was able to restart Lord of the Smash, is just like learning new stuff. That's also why like Super Smash Land, the engine was a lot better than Lord of the Smash, is because I had done some games in Game Maker just in my free time, of particularly doing different genres. And you learn a lot and you don't necessarily feel like you deleted your giant work project. You just paused it. And then maybe when you go back, that's when you can spend time like redoing stuff, because now you have like skills to redo it. Peter asks, who designs your monetization and what routes have you pursued? So I design the monetization, and it depends on project. So I would recommend for monetization to not do the Lovers of Aether route, where you just work 4 months on a game and release it for free as like a marketing joke game, because you cannot really track how successful that was. But it really depends on the project. So like on creatures, we are doing basically like the Supercell Clash Royale, very similar monetization, where it's like, it's not pay to win, because you can, like we're being lighter than Supercell. Like players right now can't really buy anything, and there's people who have maxed their decks just in beta in like a month. So it's not like as ridiculous, the grind, but it's way faster if you buy stuff. So like there is, you know, that time versus money thing where like you can pay money, skip a lot of the grind, get cards, and then play on ladder and destroy people. And then we're also selling like cosmetic stuff. So like that game from the get-go, I would say is our, most trying to get make money style, since it is Supercell, who does get a lot of flack for their payment model. At the same time, like that game is designed to generate, if it does well, which I hope it does, it's really hard to gauge that one, because it is like a card game that's like a little older and a little weird in terms of its style. But if the game does do well, it's meant to be like a service game. So like it will keep getting new stuff for a year or two, and it will generate money for more Aether games. So like the money that Creatures makes is going to get funneled back into, you know, making the comic books that you saw in the video, and making the RPG looking game with the dice and the game with the 3D model. Like it's meant to just kind of raise capital in the studio. So while I do personally prefer games that are like a card game where you could just get everything, we're also aware that to make like bigger games, it's going to cost a lot of money. So our monetization is designed both ways. It's like, how can we be fair and make money? On Rivals, I have an article on my Medium called "Why Isn't Rivals Aether Free to Play?" that goes into exactly our model. But we're basically priced as like an indie game maker game that has a bunch of content. That's kind of how our pricing works. All right, so it's 5:08. So I think what I can do is just kind of finish up. It looks like there's 9 questions left. I'll probably just finish up these questions and then probably head out. So it'll probably take about 10, 15 more minutes, I imagine. And then we'll call it in about probably 10, 15 minutes, if that sounds good to everyone. I've been searching around for a cohesive guide to making workshop characters for Rivals. Is there anything I could hear straight? Yes. Okay. So for workshop, the first place you start, obviously, is just the website. We have like the blog post of, they're not really like a guide per se, because they're just kind of like, they're more like the documentation. They're like, here's what some of the functions are and here's what they do at like the bare level. So if you ever use a game engine, it's more like, you know, the help manual, not a template or a tutorial. So that's where I would start. The second thing is the Discord is going to be a huge help. There's a lot of people in there just doing stuff. And there's a lot of workshop creators who are like, I've honestly seen multiple now where I'm like, they're a better game maker programmer than I am. Cause like, I wouldn't be able to mod this into Rivals through our mod tools. Like I could probably do it into Rivals directly, but it would take me longer than it took them. So the Discord community is the second thing. And then the third thing is, there are starting to be some resources. If you go to YouTube, there's a guy who's making his character and he's like a YouTuber and he's made episodes for every single part of it. So I'd honestly recommend just watching through his series first, because you can kind of see like what he ran into and what kind of resources he found. What is something I should start to learn right now that isn't basic knowledge or something? So I guess me as like a student or in school, right now, let's say you want to do game dev and you haven't done anything and if you looked at my presentation and you saw I had just like games in high school that honestly don't look that good, but they were like games, you just get Unity. It's free. You get it and you pick a tutorial, like a template that interests you the most. Let's say it's, I don't know, Pong or Space Invaders, you know, those kinds of games, something really simple. And then what I would recommend you do is you pick some other theme that interests you. And you follow a template, but you pick a theme, say you pick Space Invaders, right? You pick, and then you're into Westerns. You like, you know, the old, Red Dead Redemption style Western, right? You take it, you start repurposing it. So even though if your art's bad, you know, you make like a guy on a horse and he's shooting, for example, then as you're building it, eventually you're going to get to the point where the template stops. Then you take the knowledge that you learned to start turning it into to match your style. So like if it's a Western, you think what kind of mechanics make sense in that? Maybe you add a lasso, maybe you add horses do something. I don't know. This is a terrible example, but the point is you need to start shaping it into your idea, even with your limited knowledge, because just doing like this tutorial, that tutorial, that tutorial, you'll definitely improve as a programmer. But I've said before, you do kind of want to be a generalist and you want to be able to taste game design. And you also should do some basics of art. Your best thing is to like take a game, have another idea, combine them. And I might be biased because that's what literally I do as my career. If you've noticed, triple triad, element, animal, like triple triad, Pokemon, Smash, elementals, Smash Bros, furries with elements, bam, Rivals. But that's honestly a great way to learn game design and game development. All right, Steven asks, do you have a general approach to balancing frame data in a fighting game? Do you have an overall average moveset with a couple moves that stick out, or is there some other rule of thumb approach? All right, so frame data. First, the funny thing is you need to, Super Smash Land was my fourth. It was my fourth try at Smash Bros. In Game Maker. Like Lord of the Smash is actually the third, and it was terrible. And Super Smash Bros. Is my fourth try at it. That's like the first one where like I actually had frame data logic set up in the like Windows for like startup active recovery. And like no one told me about how like fighting games work when I was working on that. Like, no one was like, I didn't find like a guide on Street Fighter, like how to make a fighting game. It was more so like I had tried it so many times and I never had like control to make attacks similar to like Smash. So I like stumbled upon basically even just setting frame data. So then, and I played Smash at the time, but like it wasn't, it was like 2008, 2007-ish when I was like playing Brawl. So like, I mean, frame data was a big part of it, but like I wasn't that into like Smash until like I started developing that, like I really started to understand like what the numbers mean and everything. So the first thing is just even developing a system around it, and then balancing around it is, it's a process. Like I tweak numbers all the time. My biggest thing, honestly, is I tweak first for game feel and tweak second for balance. So like an attack is going to feel a lot stronger and beefier with like a slow startup and like a good animation to match it. And that might be what you want on your character. And then once I have it feeling good, then you tweak for balance. If you need to nerf something so much that the balance changes because you change the frame data or the feel changes, like you have a same Maple dash, she dashes forward, it's way too good. You add a bunch of recovery frames at the end. Now it's balanced, but it feels bad. You're probably gonna need to go back and change the animation. So, you know, maybe she dashes and then she like shakes a bunch of leaves off or something. Just some way that it doesn't feel bad to just be standing there. Because in Rivals, we set up the programming. We basically, we have windows that we set. We put in the game, we put in the frames. We say, this animation is 6 frames. In game, it's gonna be like 30 frames total. The first window is 10. I'm gonna stretch the first 2 frames out over those 10. I'm gonna use the next 2 over the active, which maybe is only 5. And I'm gonna use the last, oh, this is more than 6, but whatever. I'm gonna use the last like 4 over the recovery, which is the rest, which is gonna be like 16 frames or something. If you end up stretching that to like, instead of 16, you go up to like 40 frames, those 4 animations are probably not gonna cut it. So then that's when you go back to art. So that's like a long answer on like balancing frame data and, implementing frame data. In terms of balancing, you just play. That's all you can really do. Joshua asks, I am an animator at Drexel. How did you create pixel art in Rivals of Aether? And how do you scout other people? All right, so pixel art, I personally work in Photoshop and I have since I used to work in Paint, MS Paint. I think I've started working in Photoshop probably when I restarted the World of Smash. So like 2008, I probably started working in Photoshop for pixel art. You can just set everything to raster, no anti-alias, just there's guides on how to do it. There's definitely other programs for sure I would check out. I forget what Elian uses, but he uses, I think ASE Sprite. There's a lot of tools that are better for animation, pixel art animations particularly, than Photoshop. Scanning talent, I mentioned before, mostly Twitter, and just connections is the biggest way. All right, were you part of the local Smash communities before building Rivals? How much feedback did you get? Yeah, so I was in the Smash community in Philadelphia when I was in college a long time ago, like Brawl time. My first tournament I went to was at Drexel, like right near the cafeteria. And it was like 300 people for Brawl, which was insane. And my first tournament match was against Mewtwo King, who still plays Smash Bros. Somehow. Me and my friend had to play him in doubles in like Brawl. So I was like in the Philadelphia scene, but I wasn't really known. I was like pretty bad. I probably went to like 10 events total over 3 years that I played in college. And I probably averaged worse than 2-2, I would say. Probably like between 1-2 and 2-2. So not really a great record, but when I moved out to Seattle, I did bring Rivals to stuff. I definitely got more involved with Smash Community once Rivals got bigger, because that's where all our tournaments are hosted. And I did, we did have some early Smash players give feedback. The biggest one who helped out was Seth Lon, who is in Texas, who just kind of applied via email to be a beta tester. And he helped out a ton in kind of making Rivals feel the way that it does. All right, Bruno asks, considering the reputation of fighting games being hard to learn and master, do you consider Rivals to be more approachable in general? Is there anything you think could be made better in that regard? Oh, for sure. So yeah, I think accessibility is something that we definitely kind of failed on as the game got bigger. Like, we added the tutorials, but they're still definitely for people who are, who want to invest and want to learn them. They're not particularly that fun for just a casual person. And the story mode we have is a little lacking. The Abyss mode is like fun to mix things up, but once again, it's mostly fun for people who are already committed, because it's layering on top of what's already there. So I think like Rivals as a whole isn't as approachable or accessible as it could be. And I think part of that goes back to its initial design. It's like, it plays the way I wish Smash did. And I was into the Smash competitive scene. So like, I built it like a fighting game. Like, if you look just even at the main menu and the menu options, and compare it to something like Killer Instinct or Street Fighter, it's like, it's not Smash that you see. It's like local online train practice tutorial, story. Like, those are things you would see in, like, we have hitboxes in training mode, we have frame step. So we definitely treat it like a fighting game. I do think it could be more accessible. I definitely would change a lot if we were doing like a Rivals 2 or we were restarting Rivals. Because I think the genre as a whole has an accessibility problem where it's really hard to get new players in, but then the players who like it are really invested. But at the same time, you don't want to sacrifice any of the depth. Like, I don't think the solution is just, you know, erasing everything that makes fighting games fun and hard. The solution is presenting new ways for it to be fun to people who aren't necessarily invested. And yeah, hopefully, you know, studios start to solve that problem. I'm excited to see what Riot does with their fighting game. We have ideas for what we want to do, but it's not going to be solved over, you know, like, maybe some game will come out and solve a bunch of them at once, but it'll probably be solved over multiple games and people will hopefully start pooling from it. And we'll see fighting games pick up more players, or maybe they'll always stay niche. It's going to be hard to say. How did you get your professors to help make assets for you? Ryan asks. That's a great question. So how did I get the audio guy to make those songs? I think I like showed him what I was doing and I was like asking for help, maybe even to like make songs. And I told him like the thing was, the competition was ending soon. So like, I think he might've just offered to help make songs. I'm not even sure how I did that. It is impressive when I think about it now. Yeah, I think I came into it just like, I needed help because I wanted to put music in my game and I didn't know the best way to do it. And at that time, I think we were in the class, we did make like a really simple song and like a MIDI synthesizer. So I think I was just looking for help in that regard, and he offered, probably is what happened. What did you use? Yeah, so on Harrison's question, what did you use to make pixel art? Already talked about Photoshop. Peter asked, how quickly does 6 years fly by? Yeah, so that's another thing that's kind of nuts. Like, I still talk about when I started Rivals, it was me and a composer. And I'll bring that up in interviews. And like, I talked about it a lot today, but like, other than today, it comes up less and less because that was a year of development. from 2014 to the end of about a year and a half, like the end of 2015, when it was just like two of us. That was like a year, and now we've been working on the game for 6 years. So like the majority of the game has been the team. Trevor's been on the game. He's our programmer who does a lot of the character stuff. He's been on for 5 years. Elian's been on for 5 years. So we've definitely been a team for a long time. And we've had a lot of people come and go, but we've also had a lot of people who are like the core members. It goes fast. It definitely does. I feel like I was at Drexel not that long ago, but it was a very long time ago. I get the Facebook notifications from like 2011, and I'm like, oh my gosh, that was 9 years ago, 10 years ago. So it goes quick, but yeah, there's always like so much to do. That's the thing. I feel like I've been busy. At Microsoft was different because at Microsoft, I definitely had more of a work-life separation. I did travel a good bit for Microsoft for events, and even for Xbox One, we did like a tour, a marketing tour for Killer Instinct. I went to Europe for that. But I definitely had a work-life separation for that. Whereas in Rivals, there's just like whenever there's work, I'm working. I get like yelled at for being on my phone at random times, and I'm on like Discord, like talking to the team because everyone's in different time zones. So someone's working pretty much all hours. So that makes it go by faster when like there's always another, like the task list never ends. Even like Rivals Definitive, like we have like 100 things we're doing, so it never ends. That makes it go faster. All right, last question from Ryan. Speaking of accessibility and your competitive background in Smash, how much was making some Smash mechanics easier a priority? Easy way dashing, short hop. Yeah, we did do that. So the biggest thing was the accessibility on Smash story is funny. It comes back to, I said in college that I played Brawl, which was like, for those who follow Smash, it's like a simpler kind of dumbed down. A lot of people hate it in that regard because what Sakurai did is he saw how crazy people were playing Melee and he wanted to make it more accessible. So he took stuff away. But he also made like the game easier to play in some regards. Like he added a buffer. So like you don't have to be frame perfect on your inputs anymore. So I got into competitive through Brawl because that's what was big when I was in college. Then Brawl, everyone kind of realized it was bad over time. Melee got popular again. I tried to go back to Melee and it was so hard. Like everyone was so good, had such a, like I loved the skill ceiling and I loved how it looked, but like I had difficulty like playing it just because I had so much time with like the easier inputs from Brawl. So like Rivals was kind of my answer to that, where I wanted to just make it something that I could play. And in that regard, I was looking at some of the more modern implementations. So like we have a buffer in Rivals. It's shorter than Brawl. Brawl's like 10 frames. Rivals is 6. And then wave dashing, I was like, I don't understand why I'm labbing out wave dashing when it's like a pretty critical movement for both PM and Melee. So I simplified it and I was like, let's just make it so you can, you know, wave dash whenever, right after hitting jump, during jump squat. So it really all comes down to, I was bad at Melee and I wanted to make a Melee that I could play with my friends and beat them at. Yeah. And then that's where it comes from.
Dan, you have been amazing. And really, what a trooper to stick with and go an extra 30 minutes to cover so many different questions. You covered like 30 questions or more. Nice. This has been really generous of you to take the time. And I know that Adrian and I are really very thankful, and the audience obviously really ate it up. So thank you so much for being here tonight. You should go have, I don't know, dinner or something.
I'm gonna go do that.
Yeah. Thank you so much, and I'll be in touch, and we'll follow up with other stuff. But thank you so much for being here tonight. Audience is giving you applause.
Imagine thank you
in the background. And obviously everybody go out, and you can't wish list it on Switch. Because you snuck it into September, and so you just gotta wait. Set a clock, set an alarm, everybody.
Buy it in the first hour, it'll help our algorithms. We'll steamroll.
So does it have to be 12:01 a.m. on the 24th, or is it
gonna they told us it's gonna be midnight in the time zone you're in, so it's gonna be like a roll. So it should come out at your midnight, theoretically.
All right, everybody set your alarms. Get up in the middle of the night, or you're still up, obviously. I'm sorry, they're all students. You're already going to be up. Get it. Thank you. Adrian, you want to say anything in parting here?
Just really wanted to thank Dan myself. Again, thank you so much thank you so much for doing this. I really, really appreciate it. Only other thing really is to just keep an eye out on the IGDA Facebook and Twitter page. We're going to have information on our October meeting really soon, and there's some other cool projects we got in the wings.
Yeah. And Dan, you have a last second invitation to go to Brazil. I'm sure Bruno.
I just read that one.
There you go.
Thanks, Bruno. I don't have to anymore because the workshop, it brought Brazil to Rivals. So I can just visit it in Rivals now.
All right. We should let you go. Go get some dinner. Well earned. Thank you so much. And thank you everybody for being here. And from Drexel University, Game Design and Production, and IGDA Philadelphia chapter. Thank you. Good night. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. Thank you, Dan.